7481.
This is KPFA 94.1 in Berkeley, KPFB 89.3 in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno at 88.1, K248BR 97.5 in Santa Cruz, and www.kpfa.org. It's just 2:30 and time for Pushing Limits.
Welcome to Pushing Limits, KPFA's program by and about people with disabilities. I'm Adrienne Lauby, here with Mark Romoser. Today, we're going to talk about the history of disabled people who stopped traffic, barred doors, and sat, crawled, and wheeled themselves in the way of business as usual. They did it and are doing it in order to stand up for our civil rights.
Given the explosion of protest, and nonviolent direct action protest in particular, since the Trump election, we're going to tell you some of what disabled people bring to civil disobedience and other forms of protest. We'll talk about what we need for safety and how to make protests work for everyone involved.
And with us is Bruce Darling, an organization, an organizer with the direct action group ADAPT. Bruce is also the co-founder of the Center for Disability Rights. He's had a long career, dealt with a variety of disability issues, and written a number of examinations of disability rights public policy. He holds a BA degree in English from the University of Rochester and an MS in Public Relations Management from Syracuse University.
Welcome to Pushing Limits, Bruce Darling.
Hey, I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, only a month ago, 54 ADAPT activists were arrested in D.C. protesting the Republican attempt to scuttle health care for the poor by gutting, making changes to Obamacare. Tell us what happened.
Well, it was a great action. I mean, obviously, the issue was intense. So there was an attack on Obamacare, which includes a whole series of provisions that folks don't even think about or weren't even being discussed that impact people with disabilities. But then on top of that, they decided to attack the Medicaid program. So it was very personal. So we organized folks coming in from around the country to D.C. We participated in some rallies. Senator Casey had organized a rally around Medicaid services. And from there, we managed to have a tour scheduled through the Capitol. So we were going through the standard Capitol tour, saw the film and everything, and then moved to the Capitol Rotunda where they started to talk about the history of the Rotunda, and we started to make history. So we
chip in here for a second and say that Medicaid in California is called Medi-Cal.
Oh, that's right. My bad.
I just want everyone to know what you were actually fighting for is very present and problematic here in the state, too.
Exactly. I mean, it's across the country, but I should have remembered to say Medi-Cal there. So we basically clustered the group together in the middle of the rotunda and started chanting, I don't even remember what we were chanting. It was basically about the importance of Medicaid and services. And what was interesting, they've really freaked them all out, and they shut the rotunda down in real short order. The Capitol Police convened on us and basically shut folks out and pushed them out of the rotunda and arrested us very, very quickly. But we were excited in that it did get some attention. I understand we saw folks could hear us through the Capitol, and they were aware that we were there, so we were making a stand, and I thought that was very effective.
Okay, so you got arrested along with the others. That answers the first question.
So, yeah, so 54, so basically 54 of us were there. Sometimes the cops actually will ask you, you know, who's going to get arrested, and they had, in fact, asked us, is everyone getting arrested? We said we had a few folks in the group, actually a couple who were thinking that they would head out, and by the time I got back to them, they said, nope, you're all being arrested. And they just, decided that the whole group would be arrested. And it was really kind of cool because, like, an activist brought her mother with her because, you know, obviously this is a family affair. And mom was like, hey, you know, so I'm going to be arrested with my daughter. How cool is that?
Yeah. So how did you get involved with ADAPT?
Experienced or old. So I started with ADAPT years ago in the fight to put lifts on public buses. So I was a confirmed bus rider because I have perceptual disabilities and really hate the experience of driving. I do drive, but it's not a fun experience for anyone. And it appalled me that, you know, wheelchair users couldn't use the bus or folks with mobility disabilities. So I became involved in that fight. So that's how I started. And then basically just stayed with the group to fight for community integration once we secured bus access through the ADA.
And then, you know, you shifted your focus to the 1/4 of the U.S. nursing home residents who are under age 65. And have disabilities. So you're talking about the slogan, Free Our People. And I want to just mention to resistors, this started in 1983. So ADAPT and people with disabilities have been doing this for quite a while now.
Yeah, and actually it's disturbing. My first protest work was in 86. So it was a few years after it was started. And we had heard about this group that was blocking buses. And we just thought, well, you know, hey, we should try this. Since the Transit Authority won't listen to us doing all of the other things, we should just go and, you know, protest. And, you know, it was interesting. The first bus that we ended up stopping, fully, like, shutting down the bus and taking it during, like, the 6 o'clock news, within a month, the Transit Authority announced that they were going to put lifts on buses long enough so they could pretend it had nothing to do with the protest, but short enough to prevent, you know, to avoid us doing a second hit. And then they changed their slogan to Rochester Transit Service, giving all of Rochester a lift. And that, for me, confirmed direct action works.
So I've been really admiring of the number of people that you get to turn out for national actions, but even on the local level, you have chapters around the country who do local actions. People who are poor are classically difficult to organize. That's what they all say. And, of course, our community is very poor. So how do you get all these people to come and do these things?
Well, people, you know, there are people who have fire in their heart and that they want to make the world a better place for themselves and for others. And it's amazing how they find a way. So we're all doing the fun run right now, adaptfunrun.net. So we're trying to raise money but to do the national stuff. So people just sort of scrape together through sponsorships, donations. Some people will just, you know, I've seen people sleep, you know, 6 to a room and cram everyone into a van in quasi-safe setting, drive across the country or take the trains or the Greyhound, whatever they have to do to get there. But although you see a lot of the national actions, it's the local stuff that people do that doesn't get as much play. People may not realize that there's as much of that going on, but a lot of folks, whether it's the folks in Wisconsin who were going after Paul Ryan, or the folks in El Paso who were basically protesting all of the Dairy Queens, and they had a whole campaign where they were just making Dairy Queens accessible in El Paso, one by one, you know, among other things. So they have been very meticulously making their city accessible through direct action. And that is actually the meat of what we do, is the direct action that folks do locally.
Yeah, something I've noticed, this year's ADAPT action got a lot more coverage in the mainstream press than usual because it fit the narrative about the Republican attempts to cut health care. But when other people, even progressives on some of the lefty online boards I'm on, see coverage of stuff like ADAPT actions, you can almost see their mouths hanging open. Wow, people in wheelchairs are getting arrested? How do they do that? I mean, how do we sort of need to find a way to get past this casual ableism if we're going to participate in the larger social justice movement, and, you know, if they're going to include us, because right now, in the with Agent Orange in charge, it's all hands and prostheses on deck.
Exactly. We all need to be in this together. And I think we have been overlooked by progressives, and that's been really frustrating. I think one of the things that I was excited about being arrested in the Rotunda was that there was a real clear coordination that was going on with folks who could help arrange the tour, so there were people who could actually help us, and we could really partner and leverage that relationship in a different way than we have previously. So what I said to a friend of mine was, I'm hopeful, who was helping organize from the inside, I said, I'm hopeful that this is the start of a new and wonderful long-term relationship as opposed to just a one-time thing. So he said, well, our fingers are crossed too. So I think we have a lot to bring to the table, because people do stop, and not just so we catch them off guard, but everyone else stops and looks and says, hey, this must be a big deal, or they don't realize that this issue impacts people with disabilities. And I feel like we can actually be the point on the spear that gets these issues brought into the public discourse in a different way and actually advance the whole progressive movement.
You know, it's very shocking, really, because we've been doing this for so long. And one of the earliest recorded examples was in 1935. The League of the Physically Handicapped in New York City sit in at the Office of Emergency Relief Bureau, which was the Welfare League. And that league also tried to educate the unions and other progressive groups about disability. And they were branded as Reds, communists, for their troubles. So, you know, there was a missed opportunity there for the left to acknowledge that people with disabilities, I'm sure we've always been part of the left, but we've kind of been invisible.
Yes. And honestly, now I'm hoping that given the disappointing nature that history is going right now, we all need to shift it back the other way. And as Mark said, every hand and prosthesis and whatever, everything on deck to make this happen. And we have to work together.
So do you find the media, you know, the media has been kind of questionable with us a lot, kind of the beautiful quipperal kid, the pathetic child, et cetera, the heroic disabled person. How does the media cover the ADAPT actions?
That'll vary. I mean, so sometimes we'll get, every so often you get a good story, but a lot of times they don't understand the issue or they struggle. So we worked really hard to sort of streamline our message for them and talk simply so they could actually understand. Some of the best coverage we've had has been like from Al Jazeera. So it's been really cool, or The Guardian. So some of the coverage from other parts of the world have been really helpful because they actually just understood the message right away. I think here, people put the frame of the culture war over everything, and they have a hard time understanding how disability politics fit within that, particularly like around the issues that we've been working on in terms of community integration, because it's not as neatly aligned as everyone or as we would necessarily like.
Yeah, here in the Bay Area, the instance of direct action protest that immediately comes to everyone's mind is, of course, Occupy Oakland a few years ago. And one of the iconic images that came out of that was, you know, a woman we know who uses a power wheelchair, you know, participating in the action, and Oakland police throwing a tear gas canister right under her chair.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that photo actually went, you know, semi-viral. It got published in the UK, for instance.
Yeah, and there was also similar action where Scott Olsen got hit with a tear gas and became a canister. The canister got him to be disabled. He was a vet that was protesting. So there's a certain intersection here, and it's media. It's juicy, let's say that.
Well, and honestly, some of what you point to is, you know, when we say, sometimes people just think that we're using rhetoric when we say people are putting their bodies and lives on the line, but that's exactly what ADAPT folks are doing and what direct act folks, everyone doing direct action are doing, is they are putting their bodies on the line. And sometimes there's some level of self-interest. Sometimes it really is just about changing the world. And I feel like it's really incredibly noble and not as acknowledged as important and it's not valued the way it should be sometimes in our community. I think people aspire to be sort of the bureaucrat, and they forget that Judy Heumann once was organizing a sit-in before, you know, she raised to the level that she went to. So,
which was a high-level bureaucrat in one of the administrative, the presidential administration.
You're listening to Pushing Limits, KPFA's disability program. Today we're talking about nonviolent direct action protests with Bruce Darling, co-founder of the Center for Disability Rights in Rochester, New York, and an organizer with the nonviolent direct action group, ADAPT. And you said you have been involved with ADAPT since 86. That's over 20 years. How has it changed since then? How is it different in 2017 than it was in 1986?
Oh, that's a great question. So the issue has changed a bit, obviously, because we were working on buses then. Back in 86, I was just doing local stuff. And actually, even at the national actions, I was probably like known as attendant number 47. So not even in the real mix of things. So for me, personally, the change has been sort of, and I enjoyed it. I thought it was kind of like vacation. I would go, I'd help people get up, hang out with them, scream, protest, block doors, do what have you, and then finish the day, you know, at a meeting and go out, have a drink and dinner. So it's shifted, so there's lots of meetings and planning. But I think that's also collectively how it's shifted. I think we used to have sort of a very limited group of folk, or, you know, small group, maybe a couple people who really did a lot of the bulk of the planning. But we worked very hard to broaden the base of folks who are doing the actual planning, who are thinking, you know, who are thinking through the action, and who are actually working the issues throughout the year. So we now have work groups that work constantly throughout the year, building up the issues so that we can do the direct action. So I think that's a big shift in what we've done.
Yeah, I can imagine it must be difficult enough to plan this kind of event without taking disability into account. All of a sudden, on top of the logistics involved in organizing any large event, you've got people using wheelchairs, you need sign interpreters, you have people with emotional disabilities, I think you may remember the state that I was in at the ADAPT action that I went to in D.C. a few years ago with my autistic self. How do you prepare for this?
Okay, so first off, I think it's important that everyone realize when you put your body on the line, it's not easy. And the issues that we're talking about are life and death. So, I mean, first off, it just amazes me the people who are like, the protesters seemed really upset, you know. Like, okay, what do you think people who are protesting Black Lives Matter would be? I mean, this is ridiculous that people would think we would be calm as a starting point. But that's why it's really important. ADAPT is structured through chapters, and we really do the local actions and try to support each other at the local level so that we can learn each other and recognize the kind of support we need so that we can reach out. I remember one action where the cops came up behind me and grabbed my coat and pulled me backward, and I went flying onto the ground on my back, and I was younger, so I popped up and had this massive adrenaline rush. I was really freaked out, and Steve Gold was standing there, and he quietly said, "It's okay, Bruce." And hearing his voice just use my name, and sort of, it just centered me, and it brought me right back to where I needed to be. But that's something we're trying to teach each other, and that's something that we're building as a collective so that we can identify when people are having a hard time, when it's helpful to reach out and connect, and when it's helpful to give people space to sort of process what's going on. And just to help sometimes step in front of people, because other people have emotions too. You've locked the building, they're upset. For some reason, they can't get to a Republican dinner that they really wanted to go to, so they start climbing over you and stepping on you. I know, really, it's really tough. But then they actually start assaulting us, and we have to stay centered and nonviolent. So it's important that sometimes we learn how to block things so that they don't happen. So like at the Cannon Rotunda, we had the folks who were like the soft squishy ones like me, who are not metal enhanced, in the middle, surrounded by the chair users, who were all pointing out. And what it did was it actually created sort of this barrier to protect people. And we were all clustered together and felt safe, even when the police were coming and sort of pulling at us. So I think those are some of the techniques that we're using.
So I want to just take a minute and go back over our timeline that Mark prepared for us today about some of the major things that disability activists have done in the past, like 1964, White Cane Day, which was blind people demonstrating on behalf of pedestrian safety for people who use travel canes. And the blind community, we really have to give them props. They were active long before many other groups of disabled people, and most of the states had guide dog laws, you know, decades before the ADA began. And then in 1977, the 504 sit-ins, this was, they had promised to let us have entry into the mainstream of society. But then President Carter's Secretary of Health and Human Services, Joseph Califano, dragged his heels on drafting the regulations. And activists had to block off the federal building for a month to get that those just some regulations written.
Right, and the coolest part of this protest, well, several cool things. For one thing, you know, food was brought in by the Black Panthers. There happened to be one guy in the Panthers over in Oakland, Brad Lomax, who had cerebral palsy. So he got that hooked up. So the protesters ate well. And then, of course, if you're the government and you're facing a sit-in like this, one of the things you do is to cut off utilities to the building, including phone service. You know, this was many years before cell phones, so that this got to be a problem. But disability ingenuity came to the forefront once again. The deaf people in the building went to the windows and signed the messages down to allies on the outside.
So this is just, you know, it's like your wheelchairs being the barrier of the circle. There are ways that having disabled people in your actions makes a difference. And I'm talking to those of you who are not disabled. And I wonder, Bruce, maybe you have a couple tips. If I was just holding a great big march down the streets of Berkeley or Oakland tomorrow, what kind of things would you suggest I do? Maybe starting a little sooner than tomorrow, than yesterday.
Yeah, so first, I just want to circle back. The things that we have in our lives can actually really make a difference at an action. So the ability to sign through windows, we do that all the time. But we also in the deaf community had text paging long before anyone else. So ADAPT, actually, because folks from Rochester had these text pagers, were texting each other during actions long before anyone else even knew what texting was. So
right, and of course, for those of you who are not up on your deaf culture, Rochester is a big center in the deaf community, thanks to the deaf program at Rochester Institute of Technology, which is kind of like the technical version of Gallaudet.
Yeah, we have the largest per capita number of deaf folks, and honestly, that's been a real benefit, the cross disability work. So we just support each other. So the deaf folks who are involved in our chapter are really helpful at like loading up the vehicles and getting us going. And then we actually have made major efforts to learn to sign and communicate. And it's really fun. There's a whole level of another going on in terms of like sign language. So there's some creative folks in our group who take the English chants and turn them into really funny sign chants. So actually, Tommy Thompson was turned into a toilet. Tommy Thompson was at HHS, so we were protesting there once, and I was like, are you saying flush Tommy Thompson down the toilet? It was kind of like what that was they were saying, but not quite.
Could you put some of those on YouTube, please?
That's a great suggestion. I'll talk to our media folks. But in terms of making things accessible, I think we have to recognize that we need some advance notice, because arranging your attendance services, getting the accessible transportation and all of that are really important in terms of trying to get to the action. Having a clear location where you can meet up with folks that's accessible, just thinking that through. I'm surprised at the number of folks that don't even consider whether a location where folks are meeting up is accessible or whether there are accessible bathrooms. Having sign language interpreters, not only does that actually provide communication, it sends the message of inclusion. So whether or not an integration of disabled individuals and having them right up there with the speaker included in the videos of what you're doing really sends that message and people can see. So even if you don't have a significant number of deaf people or any at all at an action, that sends a message they're welcome and you'll see folks come later. And then these are some of the basic things that we need in terms of just being able to participate. I think recognizing that people may participate in different ways. I like to think of, so sometimes people think of disability as a negative or something we can't do. I like to think about how we take the things that are just part of our life and try to leverage them. So ADAPT is known for blocking doors and buildings. Well, that's in part built around the experience of three wheelchair users go out to dinner and they basically shut down the restaurant. Or at least it feels like that. So, you know, we try to leverage that. I've done some work with a group called Audism. It's with a D, Free America. So it's basically discrimination against people who are deaf or not focused on hearing.
Right. So like one particular form of ableism.
Correct. Exactly. I just didn't want people to think this was autism with a T.
So we just have a second or two left. Bruce, sorry. Try to get to the punchline.
Okay, so the punchline is I told them use your deafness in terms of the protest. So when the police come, you can be negotiating with the cops, and they need to get an interpreter, which gives you some leverage in the situation.
Excellent. It's been great to have you on, and obviously there's a whole lot more. We didn't even tell you about some of the local protest actions, direct actions that we've held, but, well, we just have to thank Bruce Darling, co-founder of the Center for Disability Rights and organizer for the long nonviolent direct action disability group ADAPT.
This is Mark Romoser along with Adrienne Lauby. Thanks to our engineer Erica Bridgman, Josh Elwood, and the entire Pushing Limits gang.
Contact us by email at pushinglimits, all one word, at kpfa.org. Our website is Pushing Limits Radio, and we're on Facebook as Pushing Limits Radio.
Pushing Limits is produced by a collective of people with disabilities. ADAPT Spring Action will be in Washington, D.C. from May 13th to May 18th. Email Michael Heinrich at Heinrich, H-E-I-N-R-I-C-H, at mcil.org.
And KPFA will cover tomorrow's Science Not Silence March from 7 a.m. to noon, as well as next Saturday's The People's Climate Movement in Washington, D.C., also from 7 a.m. to noon. So listen in. Notice the people with disabilities. We'll be there. And watch our website. A little later today, I will post a bunch of the information from this show.
And that website is pushinglimitsradio, all one word, .org.
Thank you for listening.
Now maybe someday I'll reach that higher goal. I know I can make it with just a little bit of soul. 'Cause I've got my strength and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Now look a look, look a look, a look a yonder. What's that I see? A great big stone wall stands there ahead of me. But I've got my pride and I move on aside and keep on. Yeah.
Amy Goodman, host of Democracy Now! Tune in Saturday, April 22nd for a special Democracy Now! Broadcast covering the first ever March for Science as scientists from around the country converge on Washington, D.C. to defend the vital role science plays in everyday life. We'll be live from 10 a.m. Eastern Time to 3 p.m. Go to democracynow.org for more information.
Steve Rahm, ex-Kendi, won the National Book Award for nonfiction for his masterpiece, Stamped from the Beginning, The Definitive History of Racist Ideas in America. Kendi offers us all the intelligence needed to overcome racist hatred and injustice. He'll be speaking in Oakland at First Congregational Church, 2501 Harrison on Thursday, May 4th.